amazing new research was presented at the American Society of Hematology annual meeting in San Diego this month. And I'm going to share with you my take on the top five areas of research in multiple myeloma for myeloma patients and for their care partners. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel so you can learn more about each of these five areas. The American Society of Hematology annual meeting is the biggest hematology meeting on the planet. 30,000 people were present, over 8,500 abstracts were submitted, and believe it or not, 1,200 of them were related to multiple myeloma. I promise not to talk about all 1,200 of them, so I've narrowed it down to five key areas of research that really have an impact on our patients right away. Area number one, smoldering multiple myeloma. We know that myeloma is preceded by MGUS, or monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance, and then smoldering myeloma before it becomes active myeloma. And arguably the most important study at ASH this year was the Aquila trial, which compared treating patients with high-risk smoldering myeloma with just active observation as we normally would, with actually treating them with single-agent daratumumab. And the outcomes were remarkable, with an improvement in both progression-free survival and overall survival in those patients treated with daratumumab. Area number two, frontline therapy. Quadruplets, quadruplets, quadruplets. We saw so many different studies further evaluating the benefit of giving our patients four drugs instead of three drugs, whether they were going to transplant or not. And this has really become the new standard of care. That being said, we also learned that less is more in a very important clinical trial that only gave dexamethasone for the first 2 months of someone's initial treatment for frontline multiple myeloma. Area number three, early relapse. Sadly, we know myeloma does recur in almost every patient, but we saw tremendous advances in early relapse, in particular with a molecule that will almost definitely come back into the clinic in mid-2025, belantamab mafodotin. We saw studies with belantamab being added to bortezomib or being added to pomalidomide in early relapse with outstanding outcomes and very well tolerated without the need of having to collect T cells or to have intense monitoring like we do with bispecific antibodies. In the early relapse space, we also saw updates to using CAR T cell therapy earlier, as we know we can provide this in particular in patients with functionally high risk disease. Area number four, late relapse. Wow, there was a lot of work in late relapse that I could talk about, but let me narrow it down to just a few things. Number one, we saw new generation, as it were, CAR T-cell therapy, in particular a drug called anito-cel, which demonstrated a response rate of over 95%, and that it was really quite tolerable. In particular, we did not see some of the neurological side effects that we can see with other CAR Ts. And so that has the opportunity with time to being a new standard of care. We also saw several new bispecific antibodies, two in particular, etentamig, the artist formerly known as ABBV383, which has a unique property that it is given only once a month from the very start and often does not require step-up dosing and can be given as an outpatient. The other bispecific antibody that I'm interested in is cevostamab because it has a different target on the myeloma cell. Historically, we've targeted BCMA or GPRC5D. Here's yet another acronym to remember, FCRH5. That's the target of cevostamab. Beyond that, there were even more molecules being explored. And lastly, and very excitingly, number five is what I call patient-centric research. All research should be patient-centric, but these were studies specifically focusing on quality of life. Can nutrition delay the progression of myeloma? Can we improve outcomes with more strength training and exercise in multiple myeloma? What do care partners go through when their partners are going through autologous stem cell transplant? And so many other things that were being explored, including doing less urine tests with myeloma. Maybe the pee no more model could be true of myeloma in the not so distant future. So many things that we could talk about in myeloma. These are exciting times. And if any of these five areas are of interest to you, please subscribe to our YouTube channel because I will go through each of them in more detail so that we can better understand what this means for our patients. Always feel free to reach out to us at myeloma.org.